I looked up the words I didn't remember in the vocabulary. So Voraussetzung is requirement. Stammfunktion is antiderivative. I'll probably forget it anyway again. So, but now you know. Okay, let's talk a bit, little bit about order of convergence, and let's talk about error estimates. By that, I mean the following. I would like to return to our original challenge. So we somehow want to solve the equation Ku equals G for an operator K. And all we have is an approximation G delta to G with an error level of maximum delta. Now, if K to the minus one is continuous, turn my mouse. If k to the minus 1 is continuous, then of course we have that the approximation we can compute, and that's k to the minus 1 g delta minus u is the same as k to the minus 1 applied to g, j delta minus g, because u is k to the minus 1 g. And this is less than delta times the norm of k to the minus 1. And since we assume that k to the minus 1 is continuous, this goes to 0 with an order O of delta. Okay, so if k to the minus 1 is continuous, we get the optimal rate, and that rate is delta. Now, what if we're instead looking at a regularized operator? In this case, we use the split of the error that we've used several times now. So the approximation that we get, a u alpha plus, is k alpha plus applied to g delta, alpha chosen with some parameter choice and so on, minus k plus g. And this is can be written as k alpha plus times g delta minus k alpha plus g plus the norm of k alpha plus g minus k plus g. And we already discussed this splitting. This over here is less than the norm of k alpha plus times delta. So k alpha is the k alpha norm of k alpha plus is a continuous operator if that's a regularization. So this is limited. Is limited by a norm of k alpha plus times delta, and that's really a number. And there's a second term over here, and we'll look at that in a little bit more detail a bit later. Now, what is the order of that? So how does that go to zero with delta? And you already showed that the norm of k alpha plus goes to infinity. I think you did that in the exercises. So definitely the order is not O of delta, right? So because the this choosing g delta correctly, this is this error bound is actually sharp. And so if you have norm k alpha plus times delta, k alpha plus goes to infinity, then of course it's not a capital O of delta. So the rate is somewhat smaller. So we already have to expect that the error bound, that the order of convergence with delta for that bound will go to zero slower than for a normal invertible operator. Okay, so that's number one, but that's not very surprising. Now, to discuss this a little bit more, let's assume that K is compact at this point, sigma K, U K, V K is a singular system, and let's look at the special regularization scheme, sum over K, G alpha of sigma K times scalar product of G and V K times U K. That's the blueprint for singular value-based regularizations that we've used several times now. Okay, then the second term over here, we've already computed that as well, is k alpha plus g minus k plus g, which is insert plugging in the representation of k plus g and k alpha plus g is nothing but sum over all k, g alpha of sigma k minus 1 over sigma k squared, times g and vk squared. Now, what we did is we took that 1 over sigma k over here out. So we get here something like 1 over sigma k squared, g and vk squared. And then this is the rest we have over here, sigma k times g alpha of sigma k minus 1 squared. Now, we proved that this goes to zero under the condition that sigma times g alpha of sigma is bounded above by some constant, which does not depend on, neither depend on sigma or alpha. So this is smaller than that constant squared times the sum over all k, 1 over sigma k squared g and vk squared. And this one converges, and that was Picard's condition. So we have convergence, and that's it. Can we say something about the order of convergence, about an error bound here? No, we can't, because at least not independent of G, because all what Picard tells us is that this sum over here exists. But whenever it exists, this approximation is valid, and G can be used here. So this convergence can be arbitrarily slow. You can easily construct G's that converge arbitrarily slow here. Now, if that converges arbitrarily slow, maybe that sigma k times g alpha of sigma k minus 1 squared makes that convergence a little bit better. No, it doesn't, because we have g alpha of sigma is bounded bounded above by C alpha. So if you fix alpha, then that means that sigma times G alpha of sigma goes to zero for sigma going to zero. So that sigma times G alpha of sigma, sigma KK of G alpha of sigma K is small, is almost zero when sigma K is small or when K is large. So from some point onwards, all these values over here are larger than 1/2, and that for fixed alpha it doesn't even go to zero, so that also doesn't help the convergence. The convergence really is here in this in the convergence of the Picard sum. Okay, that's bad. Oh, I just realized I wrote down a little bit more here. Do it this way. So for fixed alpha, as I said, sigma times g alpha of sigma goes to zero because g alpha is bounded for sigma going to zero. And but if you, on the other hand, fix sigma, then of course for alpha to zero, sigma times g alpha of sigma goes to one. That was one of our requirements for the convergence of these schemes. So typically sigma times g alpha of sigma looks something like this here. So it's zero, very close to zero, and higher it gets close to one. Okay, as I said, if sigma k is small enough or k is large enough, then sigma k times g alpha of sigma k minus 1 will be larger than 1/2 and absolute value. Let's take the square here. Will be larger than 1/2, so it doesn't help with the convergence. There's even a theorem that says any error bound is impossible for it's impossible to give an error bound for this type of operators, even independent of whether you use the singular value decomposition or not. So if you have an estimate of the following form, norm of k alpha plus g minus chi plus g is smaller than f of alpha for all g in d of k plus, and of course that f of alpha goes to zero for alpha to zero, then you already find that k plus is continuous. So it's impossible to give any kind of convergence rate for this convergence. Okay, but we need something, right? I mean, if that convergence is arbitrarily slow, we won't get any far. So let's return to the formula, to the error formula. So the error is given by this formula over here. Now, we already know that it might converge very slowly. This one over here doesn't help. So what could help? Well, we just have to prevent that the conversion is very, very slow. And we might do that by requiring that the coefficients g and vk, g and scalar product with vk, drop fast. Okay, so that's now our idea. We want to choose, we want to pose an additional requirement on g such that the coefficients g and vk squared drop fast. And if that's the case, then we will be able, we'll probably be able to prove some kind of error estimate. Okay, so we need an additional requirement for g. Now, is that unusual? No, it is not. Think of the very first, one of the very first things you do in numerical analysis. You approximate derivative, first derivative of a function at point x by a finite difference scheme. So that would be f of x plus h minus f of x over h. And the thing is, of course, that the left-hand side converges to f prime of x. But that, again, that convergence can be arbitrarily slow. But it gets very fast if you assume that f is twice differentiable. So in that case, you have something like this is f prime of x plus h times the second derivative of f at a point psi between x and x plus h. So this is very common and not too unusual. And now let's look at exactly the same problem, but written as an inverse operator. So kf is the integrating function of f. It's the antiderivative of f. And we already showed what k star k in this case. We computed k star and we computed k star k. That's twice integrating k adjoined is an integrating operator again. So k star k is twice integrating. So if g is in the range of k star k, that means that g is twice differentiable. So this is something equivalent to over this over here. Here we assumed that f is twice differentiable. Here, I switched f and g here, but this one, now g is twice differentiable, so that's the same condition. And we can replace it by g is in the range of k star k. That's exactly it.